Is it done? Are they gone? Am I alone? I'm alone. It's done. They're gone. Charles, you are a genius. You are an unadulterated genius. You are an indisputably extraordinary. What was that? Not a thing. You're a fool. You are alone. And it begins. Careful, careful. Mustn't get excited. Mustn't overdo it. Softly. Tiptoe. You'll get used to it in no time. Look at it. Beautiful. What a place to live. What a place to write. I shall be inspired. I shall turn out elegies and sonnets. Verses by the time at last I have a home. Nobody will know. No one in the world. And nobody will know I'm here. I am free. I am free. Goodbye, my friends, and good riddance. Pardon while I disappear. Come see me soon in my hideaway. If you can find me, I'm here. Farewell, you blood-sucking landlords, pouring your threats in my ear. Good luck forever to you and yours. If you can find me, I'm here. And I'll stay cozily hiding by day. During the day I'll resign, waiting till you go away. But at nine, master of all I survey, everything gets to be mine to own, mine to use, mine to write all the poems I choose. All alone, only me and my muse, and 40 pianos and 10,000 shoes. Farewell, Neanderthal neighbors, swilling your pretzels and beer, see you. Fair weather friends, do you miss me now? If you can find me, I'm here. Goodbye to spoilers of beauty. Ruin another's career. When you wake up with one genius less, if you can find me, I'm here. And I'm free, free as a bird in the tree, free as the slippers I wear, free with a year's warranty, free as air. All of these products and me, all that I ask is a chair that tilts, books to read, light refreshment before I proceed, and a blazer or maybe a tweed, the barest essentials a poet would need. In your barbarous jungle, screaming for ways to get clear. When all the screaming has died away, come and visit my hideaway. I will be glad to provide a way. If you can find me, I'm here. I am 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 here.
Taking a breath, I sat on the floor of the well with my back against the wall. I closed my eyes and let my body become accustomed to the place. All right, then, I thought. Here I am in the bottom of a well.
My room here is shaped just like a birdcage, and the sun extends her arm through its light windows. But I just want to smile and make patterns in the air. And so I use her fire to light my sea. cigarette. I can't be fucked working. I want to smoke.
Surging hums. Words form chains in breathing. Images form dreams at night. Sounds also form chains as days pass. We are also the object of an acoustic narration that in our language has not been given a name like dreams. I will here name them surging hums. Hums surging unexpectedly when we walk, surging suddenly according to the rhythm of our gait. Old songs, hymns, childish and protective refrains, lullabies and nursery rhymes, polkas and waltzes, sing-along tunes and popular melodies, bits and pieces of Gabrielle Faure and Lully. Wicker trunks in the dust of the attic in Ancenis, in the acrid smell of the dry, fine dust, in the rays of light concentrated by the narrow dormer windows. Almost like a plaster powder that reverberated off the ancestors' sheet music, written by lines of quignard one after the other, all organ builders and organists in Bavaria, in Württemberg, in Alsace, in France, in the 18th century, in the 19th century, in the 20th century. Most of their works were written on thick blue paper. Gold would fall from the only dormer, allowing them to be read, inciting to dust them off, encouraging to hum them. The first rhythm was the heartbeat. The second rhythm was the pulmonation and its cry. The third rhythm was the cadence of walking upright. The fourth rhythm was the assailing recurrence of the waves of the sea breaking against the shore. The fifth rhythm removes the skin from the meat that was eaten, stretches it, attaches it, and attracts the return of the beloved, dead, devoured, desired animal. The sixth rhythm was that of the pestle in the grain mortar. The unexpectedly surging hum immediately informs us about our state of being, about the mood that will govern the day, about the prey that we hail. When taught in music class, it was known as the key signature. The hum sets the tone for the space of the body. It distributes the number of sharps and flats that one will have to remember while playing the day's piece until night's progression envelops body and face without in the least muting the world.
Now through night's caressing creep, earth and all her oceans sleep. Capes of China slide away from her fingers into day. The Americas incline, coastal water shadow line. Now the ragged vagrants creep to sleep, just and unjust, worst and best. places as they rest. Awkward lovers lie in fields where disdainful beauty yields. While the splendid and the proud naked stand before the crowd, and the losing gambler gains, and the beggar entertains, may sleep's healing power extend through these hours to our friends. Pursued by hostile force, traction engine, bull or horse, or revolting succubus. Calmly till
water is wide, I cannot get o'er, and neither have I wings to fly. Bring me a boat.
The water in the harbor lies silent, so still and so deep. Moored silently, the boats are hushed, their oars are lying asleep. Above them, in the ether, on this warm night in May, there in the twilight, one last peaceful boat, it sails away. This boat is silent in the dark, but travels away from the night. Towards the endless waves of stars, to heaven and into the light.
You spoke earlier of Hegel's beautiful comments on the abyss of eyes meeting. When I see the other seeing me, when the other's eye is not only a visible eye, but a seeing eye, and I am blind to the seeing eye of the other.
Forget that I my thoughts may dim. Haste, lest while you're
again, there is a problem of understanding. Are we to say, for example, that the asphalt on a summer day takes energy from sunlight and converts it into heat? And is an avalanche, on the other hand, the response of a snow-covered hillside to the stimulus of, say, excessive yodeling?
When I was down beside the sea, a wooden spade they gave to me to dig the sandy shore, to dig the sandy shore, to dig the sandy shore. Were empty like a cup. In every hole the sea came up. Till it could come no more, till it could come no more, till it could come no more, could come no
When I had arrived, I opened two windows and a door, and the sun poured blocks and angles in, lighting up the floor's skin of feathers and dust and old grain. The windows looked out onto fields, and plants grew at the door, me killing them gradually with my urine. Wind came in wet and brought in birds who flew to the other end of the room to get their aim to fly out again. An old tap hung from the roof, the same color as the walls, so once I knocked myself out on it. For that week, then, I made a bed of the table there and lay out my fever, whatever it was. I began to block my mind of all thought, just sense the room and learnt what my body could do, what it could survive, what colors it liked best, what songs I sang best. There were animals who did not move out and accepted me as a larger breed. I ate the old grain with them, drank from a constant puddle about 20 yards away from the barn. I saw no human and heard no human voice, learned to squat the best way when shitting, used leaves for wiping, never ate flesh or touched another animal's flesh, never entered his boundary. We were all aware and allowed each other. The fly who sat on my arm after his inquiry just went away, ate his disease and kept it in him. When I walked, I avoided the cobwebs who had places to grow to, who had stories to finish. The flies caught in those acrobat nets were the only murder I saw.
Moon, so now you leave again. Overshadowed valleys full of unspent weeping. Teach me now how to stop this awful longing. teach me how to stop this awful longing. Blanch my ruby blood to pale. O moon, you seem not to hear me. Lonely one, please stay near me. See, you wrap yourself in fog. Oh, if you could do the same to all the vivid memories that bring each night to me wild sorrow. Oh, I feel lost in orbit, spins far into the darkness.
Plato's doctrine of the transmigration of souls holds that the souls of sober, quiet people, untinctured by philosophy, come to life as bees. Muhammad admitted bees as souls to paradise. Porphyry said of fountains, they are adapted to the nymphs, or those souls which the ancients call bees. There's a strange story told in Lovecock's My School and Schoolmasters, which goes as follows. A friend and I lay on a mossy bank on a hot day. Overcome by the heat, my friend fell asleep. As I watched drowsily, I saw a bee issue from the mouth of my sleeping friend, jump down to the ground, and cross along withered grass stubs over a brook cascading over stones, and enter through an interstice into an old ruined building. Alarmed by what I saw, I hastily shook my comrade, who awakened a second or two after the bee, hurrying back, had re-entered her through the mouth. My friend, the sleeper, protested at my waking her, saying that she had dreamt that she had walked through a fine country and come to the banks of a noble river, and just where the clear water went thundering down a precipice, there was a bridge, all silver, which she crossed and entered a noble palace on the other side. She was about to help herself to gold and jewels when I woke her and robbed her of this fate. Thank you.
dreams fall to out of the darkness, falling like the moonlight through space, through our quiet
I was in that state between waking and sleeping. From there, you can wander towards either of the two. You can go away in a dream, or you can open your eyes, be aware of your body, the room, the crows cawing in the snow outside the window. What distinguishes this state from that of full wakefulness is that there is no distance between word and meaning. It is the place of original naming. And from there, I saw myself before birth, more than 9 months before birth. The life to come in the womb was further away, perhaps, than death is now. To be conceived was a call to come forward, to assume a form. Yet this prior existence, although formless, was neither vague nor neuter. I say neuter rather than neutral, for it had a sexual charge, that of an undifferentiated sexuality. I was placeless and so innocent. I was unparticular and so invulnerable. But I was also happy. The only image of this happiness, the only contraband I could smuggle back across the frontier of full wakefulness, was not an image of myself, for that surely did not exist on the other side of the frontier, but an image of something akin to myself, the flat surface of a rock, a stone over which a skin of water flowed continuously.
Sure, on this shining night of star-made shadow round, must watch for me this side the ground. The late year lies down the north. Oh, summer holds the earth. Hearts all whole. Sure on this shining night, I weep for
To be clear about the possibilities during the summer and then going onwards into my friend who has been a back seat to go to the symphony quick and roll in this morning, heavy rain and snow and ice cream or not going anywhere from the heat, kind regards, heavy metal and glass of wine and big bunch of lilacs, then you can get a copy of my way to the office of your moving in the morning as evening, and I'm not coming back to be a bit late for you 3 months, heat waves, and I was also able to facilitate this afternoon and picked peonies from his garden, and the unceasing of it was broken somehow, so then I ran for the bus.
Was it all planned in advance, or was I just born by chance in July? Who on earth am I? My friends only think of fun, they're such a curious lot. Must I be the only one who thinks these mysterious thoughts? Someday I'll die. Will I ever live again as a mountain lion? Or a rooster, or a hen, or a robin, or a wren, or a fly? Oh, who am I? And the life that you know, and say, who am I? Will I ever live again as a mountain lion, or a rooster, or a hen, or a robin or a wren or a fly. If I'm one of those lives that has been reincarnated again and again and again and again and again and again, oh, who am I?
Dear Johannes, I don't know where this letter will find you, but I can't refrain from writing it because my heart is so full. I have spent such happy hours with your wonderful creation, I have played it over several times with Elise, that I should at least like to tell you so. What a work, what a poem, what a harmonious mood pervades the whole. All the movements seem to be of one piece, one beat of the heart, each one a jewel. From start to finish, one is wrapped about with mysterious charm of the woods and forests. I could not tell you which movement I loved most. In the first, I was charmed straight away by the gleams of dawning day, as if the rays of the sun were shining through the trees. Everything springs to life, everything breathes good cheer, it is really exquisite. The second is pure idol. I can see the worshippers kneeling about the little forest shrine. I hear the babbling brook and the buzz of the insects. There is such a fluttering and a humming all around that one feels oneself snatched up into the joyous web of nature. The third movement is a pearl, but it is a gray one dipped in a tear of woe, and at the end the modulation is quite wonderful. How gloriously the last movement follows with its passionate upward surge. But one's beating heart is soon calmed down again for the final transfiguration, which begins with such beauty in the development motif that words fail me. How sorry I am that I cannot hear the symphony now that I know it so well and could enjoy it so much better. That is a real sorrow for me.
Thank you.
The monkey of the inkpot. This animal, common in the north, is 4 or 5 inches long. Its eyes are scarlet, and its fur is jet black, silky, and soft as a pillow. It is marked by a curious instinct, the taste for India ink. When a person sits down to write, the monkey squats cross-legged nearby with one forepaw folded over the other, waiting until the task is over. Then it drinks what is left of the ink, and afterwards sits back on its haunches, quiet and satisfied.
So you can go like the monkey and have your fill of India ink now, if you fancy. We'll be back in about 20 minutes.